issues? Undoubtedly, because we know that transportation is one of the largest greenhouse gas emitters in the world and in Hong Kong as well. And what can be done from the government, or what have been done from the government to walk towards the green transition? So any volunteer to be the first? We have a very free flow panel today, so please just feel free. So Vanessa, please.
Yeah, I can start. I think Hong Kong has been very successful at the forefront in Asia when it comes to the clean air plan that has started a long time ago. And I think from the transportation industry have been quite benefit from that to make a transition from upgrading Euro 3, Euro 4, and then now we're at Euro 6. So when we are talking about only the electrification right now, it's a hot topic to talk about. But still, we are still in this shift, and combustion engines still play a very important role in the whole supply chain and logistic industry. And it's about closing the gap as close as possible to be carbon neutral and lower the emission step of the way. So I think Hong Kong government has been very supportive in this change. However, what I see the challenge right now to be completely electrified, or even hydrogen, we talk about some other alternative fuel, or even, you know, plug-in hybrid. There are a lot of technology that can build the bridge towards a zero carbon emission. That we don't see a lot of traction, because we do need to upgrade a lot of infrastructure in such a major city at the moment to reach that stage. So I think from my perspective, this is something that I would like to see the government can do more, have a clearer picture of how to bring all the stakeholders together at the planning stage and design, because we do need some tailor-made solution for a city like Hong Kong. It's dense, it's humid, it's very hot in the summer. It's not easy, and it's also hilly. So, but I think technology is available now. It's just that we need to test it, we need to bring our products to the city, and also work with different stakeholders to actually.
Yes, we have extreme weather as well, as mentioned by Secretary Wong. And maybe ladies first, Eileen, what's
okay. Your point? I think it's important for the government to set directions, long-term goals, and also having the relevant policies to facilitate the transition, because I believe many companies, including our company, are very committed to sustainability and want to continue our part in the green transition. But without the relevant policies to facilitate that, we will be facing a lot of challenges. For example, we are talking about, besides electricity, we would like to add new green energy, but I mean, just a company on our own, we can't bring in, or it's not easy to just bring in a new green energy. So I think it's important for the government to set directions. They say, for example, like mainland China, we understand that mainland, the central government has set a direction for hydrogen vehicles. So then the whole government and different parts of the countries will implement policies and measures to facilitate bringing in hydrogen vehicles and also refuel stations, that kind of thing. So it's important for government to play that role.
As you have just mentioned about the vehicle, then please maybe I invite CP to express your real point, because your company is doing something about innovation and
mobility. Yes, right. Yeah,
so do you echo or do you agree with Eileen saying that the renewable energy in Hong Kong is still maybe on the way, or just maybe just walking around and around at the starting point?
Well, it's not going ahead very rapidly, let me put it this way. There are a lot of solutions. Well, I agree with what Eileen has just said, that the government has to set a direction. I think the most important step the government has already done is to set out the EV roadmap. which already helps a lot. And there are milestones. Once there are milestones, you can manage the customer and operator's expectation. So for example, the bus operator, the minibus operator, they know that by, say, by 2035, well, all their Toyota, you know, minibus will go. And they have to electrify, so they better do it now. And so there is an expectation. And there are solutions from technology companies like ours. So we propose solutions. We don't just churn out products. We have to propose a solution to the customer and also to the government. For example, we electrify the minibuses, but there are no charging infrastructure in the territory. So we advocate a fast charge system, which can charge up the minibus within 3 to 5 minutes. But there will be, a number of chargings per day, but on the same route. So they can charge maybe 3 times a day, each time takes them 3 minutes. It's not a lot, but it's different from the mode of operations as they are operating diesel vehicles. So this is one solution we put forward and eventually adopted by the government now. So there's a test scheme. They were using the what we call the high power charger to electrify the minibuses. And we're also going into hydrogen, for example, where there are other alternatives like hydrogen. Well, of course, the government will say, well, we welcome any workable solutions, okay? Yeah. But then, as said, if we do not see the government is going that way, it's going to support that way, we can't invest. Because we even if we want to bring in a hydrogen tank, for example, for our R&D work, it takes us 3 years. Still, it doesn't work because it can't go through fire services, it can't go through, building department, all these things.
Up to a decade.
So a very important statement from the speaker just now is to the government has to remove obstacles. They have to facilitate. They don't really have to put in incentives in my point of view. But you have to set the framework, you have to set the direction, you have to put in milestones. And then the technologies and the operators' expectation will follow. And then it just, go ahead automatically.
Mm. Yeah. So Secretary Wall should stay here to listen to listen to more real points from the industry. And how about then, because CP just mentioned that removing barrier is his expectation maybe. Is there any barrier from NTR? Because your company should spend lots of electricity per day. Yeah. So is there any barriers for achieving a green transition?
Well, I mean, it's an area that's really important to us. And kind of being, a company provides a public service and transportation to the community. There are various areas that we're trying to do different things. We're using new types of technologies. We're looking at different aspects of our operations. And so, we're already using electricity. So actually a lot of our work is in terms of how do we reduce the usage? How do we become more efficient? And with that, we're trying different types of technology, right? And so, for example, in our stations, our property here, air conditioning chillers is actually taking a lot of energy. And is there a way for us to lower our usage there? And so we're tapping into some of the newer technologies, right? Things such as artificial intelligence and algorithms try to help us monitor along with sensors, way to kind of reduce kind of usage of our chiller. So we're kind of going through this process of kind of upgrading using this technology for some of our chillers. We're going through even broader program, even on chillers, to actually replace this with equipment that is more energy efficient. And so that's one example. We're reaching out into the ecosystem, and we actually just completed something called the carbonization. And this is something about tapping into the technology world. So you work with a partner for Carbonless, and they really helped us too. And we found a couple problem statements, right? Maybe areas that we were looking for solutions. And Carbonless helped us kind of scope different companies across the globe, right? Including companies in Sweden, Nordics, and other places, right? So they went through about 120 companies going through this process. We just had an internal kind of finalist of 4 companies. And we're kind of taking the next step, and hopefully we're going to be able to use some of this new technology. And we see a lot of this new approach is coming online. And so we are doing what we can. Certainly, you know, kind of in terms of government providing direction, it's always very useful. Certainly, I think many panelists have said government providing maybe a forum for us to walk across the street in many ways. There's only so much that we can do ourselves, right? And so kind of back to the broader, let's say, environment, you know, helping us to work with, for example, energy providers, other technology providers, you know, kind of, you know, we call this first last mile, right? In addition to our backbone transport, how do we work better with, you know, kind of, you know, buses, other modes of transportation? Are these modes of transportation more energy efficient, right? And so I think the government there can help quite a bit in helping with some of those discussions.
Mm. Okay, some of you may think that the process or the speed towards the green transition is a bit slow, or maybe can be faster. So have you thought the reason behind? Is it the reason of administrative measures, technology, or talent deficit? What do you think about it? Is it quite difficult to transform the government plan to action? Yeah. Vanessa, please.
Maybe from my perspective, from a you know, heavy commercial vehicle side, I think for Hong Kong, I mean, land constraints potentially one of the biggest challenges for our industry, because compared to passenger car, they need a much smaller space to charge their vehicles. But when it comes to commercial vehicles, we do have, we need much bigger space and to park a big vehicle somewhere and wait for the charging. We cannot be like minibus and charge in 5 minutes, but we have to have a lot more space in terms of that. The other thing is also, there's no one size fits all charging solution right now. And if I see starting experience in some other country, they do look into that, and government actually help to facilitate the charging infrastructure support to try to convince the manufacturer or the OEMs, these are the charging type that you should use if you want to introduce electric vehicles in this country. So this is something I think the government should look into and facilitate this challenge.
Yeah, it's about the question on the supporting facilities. I myself, I still have my own gasoline car. I have two cars, all gasoline, and I refrain from changing to EV because of the supporting facilities as well. Actually, everyone knows it's a problem, but the problem is still here. Is that the reason of land constraints, or is the mind of the people, is it in Hong Kong, the mindset of people is not that mature for the green transition? Do you think about it, or do you agree with this point?
Well, I think the general public, they're looking forward to this green transition. Well, all my friends are looking forward for electric vehicles.
Me too.
Yeah.
Because we are forced to do so.
Right, yeah.
Because of carbon neutrality,
A, you're forced to do so, and B, they find it avant-garde, maybe. And also with the economy of operations that, you know, everybody's looking forward to that. And I think the government is doing a great job in installing the in charges in, you know, in every buildings now. They're subsidizing it, maybe using what's something like 200 billion and, you know, things like that, or 20
billion. Something like that.
Yeah, because I keep receiving the inquiries for consultancy of installing the charges in every buildings, almost three inquiries every day. So I think eventually this charging for private vehicles will be done, and also very rapidly, you know, once this is done. But for heavy vehicles on public transport is an entirely different problem. A, because it's a land problem, and B, is the mode of operations in Hong Kong. Well, the franchise bus companies are better because they probably got bigger depots, and, you know, they can put in 200 buses, 400 buses there. But for taxis, minibuses, and trucks, they are individual owners. And every night they just park their vehicles roadside. And you can't have, you know, roadside chargers, you know, on every road in Hong Kong. So when we propose the solutions to do that, for example, for minibuses and for franchise buses, we're proposing the same quick charge solution because they are operating en route. So we can put in the terminus, we can put in the depot, or the public transport interchange. And that can be done. That can solve all the problem for if you are operating on the same route every day. But there are still trucks, you know, they go everywhere and, you know, they just don't have the time to charge when they are operating. And at night, there's no chargers. So it's still a problem, and you need to have a solution, a new technologies to come up to solve that problem. And maybe hydrogen is a way. Mm-hmm. But then when the government said, well, we welcome hydrogen, but there is no determination that we see that whether they will be investing into the infrastructure, because this is very important. And as a technology company or even as an investor, we just cannot invest in something the government eventually may not support.
Oh, yes.
Right.
And so the amount is very huge.
Yes, right. Yeah.
For our industries, the issue we see is a combination of few things, including government administration, the policy, and also the technologies. At our container terminals, there are a lot of heavy-duty vehicles like the container trucks and all the lightest vehicles working in our yard and also the other equipment. Because, for example, for your information, all the key cranes and what we call the rubber-type gantry cranes have already been using electricity. We convert all the what we call RPGs to electricity for a number of years, and all RPGs are electricity powered by 2014. But for equipment, other equipment, mobile machineries, and also the container trucks, the technologies is not yet mature, or the product is so expensive that it's not commercially viable. So in a way, I forgot to mention, for the government, I think it's also important for the government to provide some subsidies at the beginning. I understand for mainland, the central government provide, or not only the central government or provincial government provide a lot of subsidies for commercial organizations to introduce green measures. Like, for example, recently they have launched a hydrogen container truck, and according to information I've gathered, the company who produced that hydrogen truck say that the cost will be similar to the user because there's a government subsidy. Mm-hmm. Then it will be easier for users to deploy that new technologies in a broader way. Say for example, in our terminals, at the moment all the internal trucks belongs to our contractors, but we work closely with them and encourage them to introduce green measures. And one of our contractors have already introduced the first pure electric driven tractors in our terminals. And back in 2018, and right now there should be 2 to 3 tractors. But all that is with government subsidy. Then when I talk to my colleague, then okay, are we ready to turn all the internal trucks to electricity? And then my colleague told me, oh no, because the government subsidy has a limit, the quantity. So it cannot cover all our all the trucks, not only in our terminals, but in the whole port, all the continent, the whole continent port. So then it means it is not commercially viable to make a change immediately. And on the other way is also the technology. Although I just mentioned that, okay, seems that electric container trucks seems possible, but we are still in the early stage. Even with the government subsidy, is it possible to turn all the trucks to electricity is also another questions, because we have to look at charges and location of charges and all that. So it's a combination of different things.
Yes, incentive and the cost are the key issues. I'll come back to this issue later on. But I would like to ask Ben, because you are facing a very mass of people or passengers every day. And do you think about the mindset of people in Hong Kong? Are they green or mature enough to go to a green transition? Because I can give you an example. Because at every MTR station, you encourage them to walk up the stairs, maybe 100 steps, and good for your health. But if you ask anybody or any passenger at the station, oh no, of course I'm going to the escalator or use the lift. So do you think that the mindset of people is not that green enough, or we need more education?
Well, I would say this. I would say I'm pleasantly surprised. And I'll give you an example. There's one thing that we've started to do, which you may not expect a company like MTR to do. We beta launched an application called the Carbon Wallet. And actually, I'll put a plug in for that. So Carbon Wallet is something you can actually find in the App Store today. And what is Carbon Wallet? I think there are two aspects of this I want to talk about, right? So the way Carbon Wallet started was completely ground up. So they're a team of very passionate people inside the company. Nobody told them to do this. And so they thought, you know, we need something in Hong Kong to encourage everyday people to do sustainable behavior. And it could be maybe taking more public transport. It could be, you know, recycling, things of this sort. And so they came up with this idea. And within our company now, we have something called Innovation Fund. And so we use that to help provide the seed money for them to start doing this, right? And so kind of, you know, from one aspect, I mean, our own team members, our own employees, they're also, right, community members, right? So they cared about this enough. They spend their own time. And even today, there are people on the team, they're doing this part-time. I mean, they're working full-time, and then during the weekends at night, they'll come and they'll do this, right? So this is really a passion project, which kind of we're helping to incubate. And on the other aspect is then to your question, reaching out. And we're seeing that there are people, and we haven't really gone out to really promote this yet. We're still going through beta phase, but a lot of people downloading themselves. And just from this behavior, seeing that they're going and they're recycling, doing many, many things. Of course, we're trying to make it a bit fun. And there's a bit of an incentive there. If you do this, then you can earn some points and you might be able to get some green rewards. We are also using this as a way to work across the platform. So we're working with, you know, kind of companies that care about this as well. And then they'll provide some incentives, right, to help this, right? So I think it's a small start. I don't think kind of Carbon Wallet users represents all of Hong Kong, right? But I think it's really encouraging to see that there are people that care enough to create this. And that there are enough people here that actually, you know, we track the usage. They go and, you know, some of them go out of their way to go and recycle something. And so I'm actually quite optimistic, right? And I think kind of more and more you look around, I think the awareness is getting broader and broader. There are more and more people taking things like bicycles, walking. I know Hong Kong is a hot place. I've moved here 2 years, but you see more and more of this behavior, right? And so I'm quite optimistic, actually.
Maybe it's a matter of time, yeah. And come back to the most important issue is about the cost of being a green transition or green industry in Hong Kong. Because everybody or some people may link up green and the cost. Green is expensive because when you are doing green, you need to install or you need to buy some new machines or a new device to meet the green standard. And so, is it the main barrier right now for our green roadmap? Maybe CP, you can have you may have more experience on it, right? Because you're doing some technology, and technology means money. Sometimes I think.
Yeah, I would say you're 50% correct. Yeah, yeah, money certainly is a challenge, and it is the mindset. It's the upfront capital cost that is, you know, driving people away. And we still, I think most people take the mindset that green is expensive. Well, it is expensive in terms of capital cost, but we have to look at it at a different angle. philosophically. I mean,
mm-hmm.
right? Yeah, it's not exactly that, you know, it is a capitalistic mind, mm-hmm. you know, that is, everything is driven by money. But we are, when you look at the end of the day, we are talking about survival. Yeah, it's not anything money can buy. So, well, you will have to change. And it is sad that even we as a, you know, as an EV company and as a technology promoter, that we will have to convince people in terms of money. Okay, there's a big upfront cost, but the operating cost will be much less. And we always will have to convince, you know, our customers saying, yeah, your ownership cost is much less over the life of the vehicle, for example. In terms of our minibus, you know, you probably can save 2 million, you know, out of the 15 years life, as against what you're operating now. So, well, it is a fact, but still there's it's a big hurdle, you know, for people to put in high capital costs. So, well, there will be have to other solutions, like, well, when we're talking about green finance and, you know, all this kind of thing, that, well, we will be putting something out like, you know, why not you put in installment, and maybe there will be green finance that can finance you, you know, on this kind of purchases, or we even put out options like a battery leasing, so you don't have to buy the battery, which represent the, you know, a big chunk of the cost. So when you buy the vehicle, it's even cheaper than you buy a Toyota Coaster now, right? Yeah, but then you have to lease the battery, which will be part of your operating costs, like you will have to do refueling. You know, kind of, you will have some innovations like that to overcome, you know, that kind of thing. But still, yeah, money is a big, big challenge. And the mindset is a big challenge as well.
Yeah, because for human beings, we usually very short-sighted. If you ask me to invest a lot, but the future is, I haven't got a crystal ball, and so I don't know the future, and so maybe I will have some hesitation. So do you guys agree with this viewpoint, or money is quite a decisive way or decisive point for being a green world or green future?
I would say yes and no, because I believe many companies, including our companies, are prepared to invest for the future, for the betterment of the whole country or the whole world. But the thing is, there's always a balance. We also have to look at the bottom line and the feasibility of the business. The reason why I said yes and no is, at the same time, say, for example, we have been working to convert all the lightings on our key cranes and RDGs into LED lighting. And of course, we have to invest in the conversions, but just take the LED lighting on our key cranes. Right now we have converted, I think, on 17 key cranes. And each year we can save already about 1.8 million units of electricity. So in a way, that is why it's yes and no. So it's a lot of study being put into, okay, whether it's feasible to launch a project or not. But as I said, that's why I said yes and no. But if I just mentioned about, a container truck, if it is that many times more expensive, then it might be difficult or some obstacle for any company to roll it out in an massive way.
Mm. So we need some real examples or real case study on the green transition, just like Mr. Assazan said, if steel industry can, everyone can. I think it's the similar ease or similar philosophy in Hong Kong as well. Dan, do you think about this? Do you agree with this viewpoint? If steel can, everybody can.
You know, I think this certainly takes a lot of will, right? Because it's such a complex set of issues, right? And I think there are things that are related to use of technology. There's a certainty. I want to tap into a little bit what you said, which is, it's green expensive. Actually, expand that any new technology, anything new is expensive. When you're doing new, you don't have the kinds of scale. So it's not really just green. It's just a common problem that you know, kind of you face along any kind of a new approach or any kind of a new technology. You know, but there's no question now that there's a high level of awareness. You know, companies like everybody on this panel, belong to organizations that really care about this and are spending the time to kind of, you know, using our own resources to look at ways that we can contribute. And so certainly I think there needs to be a lot of will to kind of put in and to try some new things, to invest earlier before you really have proof that it works. And so I think it's a common challenge that we all face.
Can I add one thing mentioned about scale, which is important. Our company has recently set out sustainability strategies and including very bold targets. We aim to eliminate all our direct emissions from our operations by 2030. And during the discussion, some colleagues said, oh, right now we don't have the commercially viable technology yet. But then our group MD said that, okay, we have to make this bold decision and also create demand for technology companies to make things commercially viable. Because if those companies don't know that, okay, there are so much demand in the market, then they might not invest in the technology's advancement. So I just want to share that.
So we need to create a trend. So Vanessa, you think about it, it's a trend, and so we cannot resist this because of the carbon neutrality goal is our main goal.
Yeah, maybe I'm here in a very different position than the rest of the panelists, because we are one of the very first transport company or automaker that signed the Paris Agreement. Scania, as we have been dealing with this for a long time. And first of all, we have admit that we are the emission, we have to be responsible of what we produce. So we look into our own operation, a bit like Evans company is doing, how to reduce emission in our operation, and then towards technology advancement to improve our products. So when they are out there running on the roads, the emission is getting lower and lower every year. And in fact, we just upgraded our combustion engine just recently. We get a lot of feedback, like, why are you doing this? We should go full electric, but it's just not there yet. That's why closing the gap is important, while also give transportation or greener solution to companies so they can slowly convert into this full shift to reach carbon neutrality. So I think, of course, the trend is there, and as Scania is extremely attractive as a company as well, because we also have to continuously attract new talents to join into this industry to, you know, build and do a great research and development of the product. And if you don't choose this green transition for your company, you will also be getting less attractive, and it's hard to recruit talent to advance in your technology and development.
Yeah, just as Mr. Assazan say that one industry affects the other, and so the most important thing is we work together to overcome the obstacle, because this trend is a fashion as well, the fashionable trend to be the green transition, and we have set many goals in 2050, we have the carbon neutrality, so we work hard to achieve this goal. Thank you very much for sharing your views and thoughts with us. Let's put our hands together.